we will cover this mainly the serverless architecture. In that specifically, we'll focus on the Azure Function in this session. Okay, so first of all, the what we need to understand is, what is it we're going to cover here? One is we'll understand high level what is serverless. We'll understand compare cloud computing with serverless computing, and understand the regular scenarios where you're already using serverless architecture but you're not aware. And finally, we will see how it works with respect to Azure Cloud and how do we create. Okay, so a serverless computing is basically, it's a part of your cloud computing, wherein it's one of the services or offering from cloud computing, wherein you don't own the infrastructure, right? So everything is managed managed by the Azure, the cloud provider. And you just use a service to deploy your application, deploy your services that you have without having to worry about managing the infrastructure. So what it means is you don't have the flexibility to even decide what is the OS it runs on, what is the hardware, what is the the infrastructure required for this service. But you can control automatically, kind of scale up or scale down the service based on the need. Example, I may have a 4 GB, I may have a performance of 8 GB or 16 GB RAM, but suddenly because my load is high, the serverless architecture automatically gives us options to increase the infrastructure or decrease it based on the load. And all we do is we just configure, and infrastructure is maintained and managed, upgraded or degraded by the cloud provider itself. So what it means is you don't have any control of infrastructure, and you don't have to worry about infrastructure at the first place. You just have to take your application, deploy, and pay for. Generally, most of the services are pay per usage. So it's not like I'm not using the I've created a serverless service, but I'm not using it every day. I don't have any load today. We may not pay for that if we are not using it. So example, if I have a Azure Function which I've created and I'm only making, say, 10 calls a day, example. So I only pay for those 10 calls instead of, even though it is running for most of the day, right? So that is the advantage that you get in a serverless architecture compared to but that other side of it is the infrastructure, which you generally, if you don't have a control over it, you will have issues with respect to probably your the OS version or your infrastructure side of it. And similarly, cloud computing, as I said, serverless architecture is one of the part or service of a cloud, overall cloud offering, right? So the only difference here is, in case of serverless architecture, everything is managed by the cloud provider. You just manage or deploy your application and take care of your application or the service. Everything else is managed by the cloud. So that is the main difference. But in cloud computing, again, I'm sure you're aware of infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, software as a service. These are various offerings that every cloud provider provides, right? So serverless architecture comes under something like a similar to a platform as an architecture, where everything is taken care by them. You just use a platform to deploy your application and manage it, right? So one example could be, I don't know if you have used this SQL Server, Azure SQL Server, right? So where everything is managed by them, you just create your databases, you create your servers and SQL servers and database, and start connecting to that. So that's one of the example of a serverless, where everything is there managing. You just use the platform to create a database and start developing your application or managing the data. And it's similarly, I don't know if you've used something like a Power Flow or various other Power Apps kind of concepts, wherein, again, everything is managed by them. You just use the software side of it or the platform side of it to develop your applications and go live. You don't worry about the infrastructure, right? So similarly here, just to compare what is the advantage of a cloud computing as provided. Now, when we're comparing cloud computing, we'll be comparing with respect to, let's say, an on-premise server, on-premise, data center or a server, right? So basically, the obvious advantage of a cloud computing is everything is managed over a cloud. You don't have any infrastructure on your end. So that provides an unlimited access to your infrastructure, storage, or everything that you need based on the need. So it's not like I may not need, I may not need a 32 GB server every day. I may need only when my peak is high, right? So, but in case of a data center, I'll have to always have a 32 GB. So, but here, once I move to cloud, I can, depending on the load, depending on my traffic, I can reduce and increase the RAM size, which will directly impact my cost, right? So similarly, any options with the infrastructure, software access, security, everything can be managed easily and customized based on the application they need. So the cost, as I said, everything is based on the usage. So if I don't need a 32 GB, I just need a 4 GB, I only pay for what I use. And I don't, and when I need a higher environment, I will scale up, use it, and then when I don't have traffic, I'll scale down. So that's the control we get when we go to cloud computing. And the cost is also according to the usage. In most cases, there are some services you always have to pay, but in most cases, that's the case. Generally, there are some disadvantages wherein, when it comes to security, when it comes to if you have a specific application with a specific software need or a OS need, you may struggle with respect to finding the right infrastructure or right service for this, right? So generally in such scenarios, we go for a virtual machine kind of thing where everything is virtual machine, just like your on-premise server, and everything is managed as a VM. Right. So those are some advantages, especially when you have a very special requirement. Example, right? When you have you want to do something like a mainframe application to be migrated. Mainframe is a very old technology. You may not directly get a service which is equivalent to a mainframe. So there's a workaround to be done. So serverless architecture, as I said, automatic scaling up, scaling down, whatever we need with respect to providing the service at the best SLA. Automatic scaling allows us to do that. There is no infrastructure to maintain. There is no, because you're not managing any infrastructure, there is no cost involved. There is no complexity of managing the whole software. You just worry about your code and application. Everything is taken care of. Lower cost, as I said, in most cases, it is based on the usage. I may run it for 24 hours, but for the usage I pay for it. And as I said, which is basically a deployment, everything, you can just deploy it, only application deployment, nothing else to be done. So it becomes easy for you to develop new features, new application, deploy and go, take it to live. So again, security issue is always a concern when it comes to cloud, especially in serverless, because you don't have control over where it goes and how it is secured, right? Though, there are many security layers, you'll always have issues with respect to security and debugging. So example, when you have a serverless, how do you debug? If something issue happens on the server, on the cloud, on a serverless service, how do you debug? So from a local environment, how do you debug? So that's where, enabling monitoring and logging and everything will add to your cost, but that is something, a new way of debugging that you will have to figure out. So this is, again, when it comes to scenarios of a serverless, anything that you see currently in Azure or any other provider, there are many serverless services already available. It could be, your mobile APIs, it could be your messaging. When you send a message, how does it work? It's all serverless. Similarly, these are scenarios where a serverless will apply. Example, you have an IoT data processing system where data is coming from multiple devices, and you can just get all those messages, process them, and save it using the IoT hub, which is a serverless. You don't manage an infrastructure for it. So similarly, depending on your need and scenarios, we will generally decide to go with serverless or go with the different services where you have the control over the infrastructure. And in Azure specifically, right? Again, these are the various serverless services in Azure that we get. Right, whether it's, again, as I said, database, Azure SQL is a database or Cosmos DB where you create a Cosmos DB or a SQL DB and you don't have control over the server it is running and where it is running and how it is running. So that's and storage, you have blob storage, various storages which just get stored and you don't have you don't have control of the infrastructure where it is getting stored. Though you can control where and how to replicate and how to do that, you don't have the control. The whole DevOps and developer tools that we have is all serverless, because we just create Azure DevOps systems and start deploying them, or use the pipelines to deploy, but you don't know where the infrastructure is running, how it is running, what is the hardware infrastructure and everything. So workflows and integration, again, there are many serverless architectures. Like we are looking at Azure Function here. There are many other things like Powerflow and Logic Apps. These are different workflow orchestration tools or serverless services that you can use together to achieve a serverless architecture. Okay, so, and similarly here, as I said, monitoring, analytics, Power Automate, Azure Functions, these are different serverless services that Azure Cloud provides. And in this session, we are only focusing on Azure Function. Yeah, there will be future sessions on each of these topics, but today we'll be focusing on Azure Functions. Okay, so this is a, you know, overview of what I was, you know, I was trying to cover. Now, what is the what is the difference? How is it cloud app? You asked, right? How is it different from cloud app hosting with respect to serverless, right? So, cloud app hosting, I'm assuming you mean app services, right? Application services, or there's something called Azure App Service, right? So, Azure App Service is, again, there you decide when you're creating an Azure App Service. Right, you decide at that point. You decide what is the we select the size of the app service, right? Whether it's you would have seen something like P1 V1, P1 V2, S1 F1. These are various standard packages kind of, or standard size of available based on which you will be charged. So now when you select a P1 V1, you get a you know you're getting a 32 GB RAM. You know you're getting a 4-core 64 GB RAM, example. So you have that initial control over, you're deciding what to do. But when it comes to Azure Function, you're saying, I want to create Azure Function with this XYZ. But you don't know whether the service, the Azure Function is running in a 4-core, 2-core, 10-core, or 64 GB. You are not aware. You don't even know. You cannot decide. You cannot tell, I want to use a 32 GB. RAM for this Azure Function, right? So, but in case of an app service, you're going to select a size which directly maps to number of operations you're going to do, and the size of your the RAM or a 2-core or a 4-core. So that's the difference. Where that's why Azure App Service is generally, that's not a serverless, because you are deciding the architect infrastructure and you have control over that. Example. Now we discuss the traffic, right? So example, let's say you create an app service and you get more traffic, right? Now in app service, you're going to configure that. Okay, if I get a more traffic, if my traffic is X, then increase the number of app services to N. Example, initially I have 1, you make it 2 or 4. Or other ways, if my traffic is high, or if my number of requests is high, maybe increase the RAM from 4 GB to 12 GB, or 4 GB to 16 GB, example. So that is where this is the scale in and scale up and scale down kind of features in app service, where you're directly deciding the infrastructure size, infrastructure, how many services you need. Again, but when it comes to Azure, specifically an Azure Function, you're just going to say that, okay, scale up is scaled, auto scale up, you're going to enable that. Now, Azure Function decide, if it suddenly gets 100 requests, it will decide, okay, I have to spawn 10 or 100 different Azure Functions. But if it just gets 1, it will just spawn 1, example, right? So again, the difference you need to understand is you're not having the control over where it is running, what is the infrastructure configuration it is running. It runs and it takes care of based on the settings that you given. But with respect to an app service, you kind of pre-configuring what is the infrastructure you need. If I get 100 results, 100 traffic, 100 requests, I need a 4 GB. If I get 1,000, maybe increase it to 16 GB. So you're going to decide, you pre-configure that. But in case of a serverless, you don't have that option. You just enable auto scaling and with basic settings, but the backend cloud provider takes care of assigning that ensuring the SLAs are met for that particular serverless architecture or serverless service. Okay, so that is the main difference. So app service, we generally go for when we need some control over the environment. So as I said, whether it's a RAM size or your OS type, operating system, example, sometimes I need a Windows-based app service. Sometimes I may need a Linux-based app service. But in Azure Function, it doesn't, you don't have, generally we don't decide which one to, it doesn't matter because we just deploy your application, you create Azure Function, deploy your code or develop your code and deploy. So that's a difference when it comes to the main difference, right? There are many other, there's a cost-based difference and then there's why do we use it, when do we use an app service and when do we use a serverless? So there's a specific scenarios where we decide, okay, for this scenario, serverless makes sense compared to app service example, right? So that's a kind of a where we decide what to do. Even in serverless, as we saw, there's a Power Automate, Azure Function, Logic App, web jobs. There are four types of serverless. So which one to use when? Again, it depends on the scenarios, depending on your business need. Not every time Azure Function will not work. Every time Logic App will not work. Sometimes we need to integrate Azure Function with Logic Apps to get the result, right? So it depends on your business need. And so we need to have the understanding of why Azure Function works, where it works, why Logic App works. So Logic App is basically an orchestration kind of a workflow. So it can internally call Azure Function, it can internally call web jobs, it can call a Power Automate example. It can orchestrate multiple requests or integrations. Right? But Azure Function is trigger based and it is triggered based on various conditions. Right. So there's a differences in each of them. There's a cost difference. There is a purpose of each of them. Right. So again, as I said, in this session we'll focus on Azure Function. But yeah, so in future we'll have more for specifically on Logic Apps as well. Okay. So now